We're heading into session three, which is the process that we've been talking about on readiness and needs and modernization and acquisition. And to do this, there's some discussions that were brought up yesterday in the industry panel. So we'll have more of those, I'm sure. When you write questions, please think about them. And don't just put them in right off the bat. If you think about them once or twice, I bet you'll change them and make them short. So this panel will be the OTA success stories. I know the general hit on the acquisition system being a long process. I think everybody agrees that OTAs have at least punched that in the face a little bit and helped it out. So to lead this panel, we have Jeffrey McGurgel, and he is a stellar guy. I've known him for many years now. I knew him when he was a Marine major in Georgia doing contracting. And Jeff is a true Marine with a sharp mind and a deadly knowledge of contracting. And he definitely has got the Army can-do attitude, because there's nothing he cannot do when he gets his head around it. So Jeff, this is your panel.
You heard my name a few times yesterday. I'm not sure I can live up to my reputation, but I'll do my best. At this point, I'd like to have Mr. Dave Hanson, Ryan Altenbaugh, join me up here on the stage. And Dr. Moore, if you're, there you are. What we'll do is I'll just give you some opening remarks, and then I'll introduce each speaker. You'll address the crowd from your seat. We'll talk a little bit about their companies and their experiences with OTAs, and then we'll go into your questions. But before I start, let me share a few things with you. So this afternoon, the JPMs will be giving you their forecast. I think anything that's not on there that may have been briefed at the APBI or that's on the website, you feel free to reach out to me and I'll track down. A couple of you have asked about the detection technologies for unknown biologicals, so that one I am tracking down, and I will provide you feedback on that if it isn't briefed this afternoon. The Compact Vapor Chemical Agent Detector Program did go on the website. I did meet with the project team this week. That one may actually be initiated in DITRA. I can't say too much about that because that agreement is not finalized and who's going to fund it, who's going to initiate it. But that one also you should be seeing here before too long. As far as awards, CSERP is right around the corner. Mr. Secord asked me every day, are you done yet? So. You should be seeing some of those first awards as early as next week and then throughout the next couple of weeks. Rosetta also is moving right along. I'm very happy with the progress that team is making and working with industry. And particularly, I've reached out to all the companies that bid that were selected for award, and they've turned to, they've met all the requirements, and they'll get end-of-year awards for sure. Then right behind them, all the JPMP requirements and JPL soft, CBRN soft also is in the queue. So it's moving pretty quickly. If you have been selected for award and you're in negotiations with statements of work, please make it a priority. You are up against literally dozens, if not maybe a couple hundred other awards that are in the queue at Army Contracting Command New Jersey. And the quicker you can turn those things in advance of the formal request, the better for you and the better for us. Now, you know we have OTA authority within DOD. We can do R&D and prototyping. Within the JPO, we have two consortia. One is medical-based, it's managed out of Fort Detrick for medical countermeasure systems, and the other one is the CWMD, which I helped establish, and that's both of them. It's got 3 years of progress on medical and then the non-medical. We've been in this 2 years. And I think it's been much better than anyone expected. I think the only one that is not surprised on what we've been able to accomplish is probably Mr. Bryson and Dr. Roos, but everybody else just can't believe how much we've been able to accomplish. Well, that's because of you. We talk to industry, industry talks to us, and you can tell the results. It's just really amazing. Some questions came up yesterday, so let me address those real quick. Some general said something about the basket. So does the basket have a bottom? The bottom line is that when you submit a white paper and it's evaluated, if it's found to be acceptable, it automatically goes into the basket. The basket means you have a live proposal for 36 months. You can take that proposal and you can take it to another agency as long as they have the prototyping authority for other transactions, and they can actually pull it out of the basket, go into negotiations, and make awards. Now, we haven't really emphasized this, but we've already made several awards from projects that were pulled from the basket. I think the mass personnel decontamination system was pulled from the basket. There's a couple of CCDC projects that are in process right now. And I don't want to tell you too much about it, but there are a couple of program managers at the Defense Threat Reduction Agency that are looking at a list of proposals right now that they may fund within end of year funds. So once I get that list, I will be calling your contracting POCs and we'll start the negotiations on those as well. Does everybody in the basket get an award? No, that's not the way it works. But like I said, you're free to take that technical solution, take it to any agency with OTA authority, and if they want to pull it out of the basket and fund it, I'll be happy to support them. I just need to get permission from the program manager that originally solicited the requirement. The other thing, there was another question about how do I get fair and equal access to government program managers. Well, if you've been on the website, you probably see and you know that Mr. Bryce announced a joint DHS-CWMD office industry day in Alexandria a couple of months ago. So Mike Stebbins from ATI, Jennifer Nicholson from our headquarters, myself, and two counterparts from the DHS-CWMD office have been planning that in the background. We have signed a contract for the facility. We have a draft agenda, and we'll be opening up registration for that very quickly. This will be a joint event. It's an industry outreach event, and DHS will be highlighting their FAR-based requirements and OTA requirements for you. So, if you want to meet with government counterparts in DHS or DITRA or the JPO, that's the place to be. As you know, last year at the general membership meeting, we did 300 one-on-one sessions with government and industry in one day. And I can tell you, Mrs. Bryce was pretty happy about that. So this time I want to do more than 300, but you've got to be there. In addition, every time we release a statement of objectives, it has the AOR's contact information, and they will answer the phone. They've been instructed to answer the phone at least once. Now, if you have a technology that they're not interested in, they'll tell you. If anybody knows Tim Tharp, and he's the Sioux, or he's the AOR in the Sioux, he'll tell you straight up, forget it. We're not interested because it doesn't meet the weight requirements, it's vulnerable to attack or whatever. So we try to be upfront with you so you're not wasting your BMP on capture and writing proposals that really just aren't going to be awarded. Okay, with that, I think I will be quiet and then I'll introduce our panel members. I'd like to start with Ryan Altenbaugh. What we'll do is that you'll go through your background and your experience using the OTA, but from your seat, you don't have to come up here, and then we'll go into the questions. So Ryan is definitely one of the best users I've experienced with the OTA process. He gets it, he's very smart, and he's had quite a bit of success in using it. But there are a lot of other ones too, and I don't want to de-emphasize those. It's just Ryan, I managed to trick him into coming up here. He's got about 14 years experience in acquisition in the field of chemical and biological defense. He has a depth and range of technical and program management experiences in chemical detection and protection programs, testing and evaluation, and rapid development of projects and systems and systems integration. He possesses a master's degree in systems engineering, a bachelor's degree in chemical engineering. He's a member of the acquisition corps, and he has certifications in engineering and program management. I would describe him as one of our top experts in non-traditional agents. So at this point, Ryan.
All right, Tom.
Thank you. Thanks, Jeff. I appreciate your comments. I want to say, I don't know if I'm the expert, but I'm glad to be up here and talk about some of our experience from the government side of using the OTA. So the work that I'm on our team is the NTA Defense Non-Traditional agent defense team, one of the things that we do a lot is look to industry to see what technologies are out there that might address the non-traditional agents, emerging threats, test them, kind of see what comes out of that, and work to develop things going forward. So a little while ago, we had a couple different requirements projects we were looking at and said, hey, what's the best way to go to contract this, like we always do. Came to Jeff Megargel with some of the requirements, said, hey, there's a couple of these projects. Is the OTA the right place maybe to do this? And once we got into talking with them, it turned out the OTA was probably a good fit for the kind of work we do, this sort of rapid prototype test and evaluation, you know, that goes like 6 months to 24 months kind of time period. So we said, okay, well, let's start this process, go forward with them. This is kind of what I talked to you guys about, was to put together our requirements, say, yeah, we're looking at maybe prototyping a type of traditional technology that has the potential to be miniaturized and then testing it for NTAs, emerging threats, other traditional type agents. Put it out there through the OTA, and we had a lot of response from industry, and the OTA gave us the capability to really talk with these folks ahead of time to show us, hey, this is what we have. Does this kind of fit what you're looking for? Make some tweaks, perhaps, to the statement of objectives, and to say, okay, I think I have something that might fit that requirement, and you maybe get some access to some other groups that we hadn't done before. As part of that, too, we went to the OTA symposium. We did some of the one-on-one sessions with a lot of companies. Said, yeah, there's some requirements, and saw potential for a lot of other projects within the area of non-traditional agents and defense. Said, well, this is perfect. Did the statement of objectives. We came back with a couple different partners from industry with very good proposals. We were able to evaluate those, select one. We put another two in the bin as it was, and say, hey, let's develop this a little bit more. We think that this is going to be great. It's a collaboration. The particular proposal that went forward was a collaboration between a small business and the University of Calgary, which is someone that we wouldn't normally have worked with, but they had some interesting technology. Said, oh, this is great. We can prototype something in a short period of time, you know, and test it right at Edgewood. If something comes out of it, we have some interest from perhaps end users of the technology. And so our experience using the OTA again to start with it was very positive, and I look forward to being able to answer any questions or provide feedback to any of the other government folks that are interested in looking at the OTA.
Thanks, Ryan. Next we have Dr. Dave Moore from SciTech. He's the President, Chief Operating Officer of SciTech Services. Prior to joining SciTech, Dr. Moore served for 18 years with Vitale Memorial Institute as Vice President for Business Development for Life Sciences Research. Prior to joining Vitale, he served 21 years in the United States Army, concluding his military career as Director of the Medical Chemical Defense Research Program at Fort Detrick and Deputy Commander for the United States Army Medical Research Institute for Chemical Defense at APG. Dr. Moore is board certified in general toxicology and veterinary preventive medicine, and has for 15 years served as the editor for antidote development for the Journal of Drug and Chemical Toxicology. Dr. Moore has also served two terms as a member of the National Research Council Committee on Toxicology, and is appointed member of the United States Air Force Scientific Advisory Board. Dr. Moore.
Good morning. Can everybody hear me? I can't hear myself. Yeah, great. Good morning. It's a pleasure to be here. As Jeff said, I'm Dave Moore. I'm president of a small company located in Habit of Grace, Maryland. I want to tell you a little bit about that because Jeff, I'm also a business developer, so I want to tell you a little bit about that small business just in case it touches a nerve, or you can identify as a small business being able to utilize the OTA process. It's not made for large businesses. It's not made necessarily for companies that have an intellectual property. If you have some capabilities similar to what I'm gonna explain what we did, you might find the OTA process is very good for your business. But we are a small business. We have about 70 employees. We operate at the $15 million size standard, so we are a small business. CBRN has always been our focus. The business has been in CBRN for almost 30 years. We're branching out into other areas, but we have some IDIQ contracts like JE Class, JERDAP, we're prime contractor on that, we're prime contractor on the RS3 contract, if you're familiar with that one. We do some work with the Army's Small Business Innovative Research Program, where we're the prime contractor for managing that program management office. So that's the kind of work that we do. So what do we do with regards to OTAs? SciTech is a charter member of three OTAs, the Defense Ordnance Technology Consortium, the DOTC contract up in Picatinny Arsenal. Even as a small business, we served as a prime systems integrator and ran about $35 million worth of developmental projects through that DOTC OTA process. We're a member of the CWMD, Countering Weapons of Mass Destruction. We haven't been able to crack the code on that one, by the way, Jeff, so we're looking forward to it. And we're a member of the Medical CBRN OTA, supporting the Joint Program Office for Medical Countermeasure Systems at Fort Detrick. That's the reason I'm here today, because we just completed a project on that. It didn't necessarily, was not perfect in terms of the process, and I'm prepared to describe some of the pimples that were associated with that, but ultimately it was successful. And so I look forward to, if there's any questions on essentially what that project was or the process that we went through to do it, I'm open to discussing that. I look forward to it. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. So next we have Dave Hanson from Dave Wheatley Enterprises. He's a native Marylander, born and raised here. He has a Bachelor of Science in Biology. He's a program manager at Dave Wheatley, and he's been there for about 2.5 years. Before that, like so many of us, he's an SAIC alum in Lidos. He was there for 13 years, where he served as system engineer and product manager supporting various Department of Defense agencies, to include the Joint Program Executive Office for Chemical Defense. Dave.
Morning. Thank you, Jeff. As Jeff said, I'm Dave. I've been with DWE now for about 2.5 years. We're a small business, very similar to how Dr. Moore described it. We're located just down the road in Belcamp, Maryland. We've got about 80 employees. Dave started his business back in the medical industry years ago, and then probably in the early 90s, I'd say, kind of got into the CBRN arena, specifically supporting some different mass development projects. You know, fast forward to now, he's grown quite a bit, not too much, but enough, and now we are have a wide range of capabilities to include, you know, prototype development, engineering, training, full manufacturer, and life cycle support. So a lot of overall capabilities, and a core competency right now still continue to be plastic molding injection, as well as the chem bio defense with focus on the respiratory protection. I'd say business is probably split between 50-50 between those two. We're ISO compliant, NIOSH registered manufacturing facility. I've been supporting the JPEO-CBRND, JPEO-CBRND, OTA, TACOM, as well as different commercial and aerospace industries. I think being, again, similar to what Dr. Moore said, being a small business has positioned us well to be able to respond to some of these needs that have been identified here in support of modernizing chem defense initiative. I think the OTA so far for us have been a pretty good vehicle to help enable that support. We're currently part of three different ones to include CWMD. We are on the Consortium for Energy, Environment, Demilitarization is another one, as well as the Naval, blank on the name of that. It's another one that runs out of CMG, it's the Naval Branch, Naval Airspace. To date, we've probably been a part of seven different proposals, I'd say, whether we're leading them or we're teaming with somebody else. We've won a couple, we've lost some, and we've had some overall pretty good experiences along the way, so hopefully some of my experiences I can share will shed a little bit of light on the process, and hopefully I can answer any questions you might have.
Okay, thank you. If you don't mind, just let me point out, is Mike Stebbins out there somewhere? Yeah, so Mike Stebbins is the program manager. He's my counterpart in both OTAs, both the medical and the CWMD. He is part of Advanced Technology International, and they're our partner that is responsible for managing both consortia. So if you haven't talked to him, he's got a booth out here. I would warn you, though, if you're not in the consortium, today, there is a backlog at DLA. It's going to take about 6 weeks to get you approved to join the consortium. So that means that if an RFP comes out that you're interested in, you're probably too late. So word to the wise, to If there's something you're looking at, please join the consortium sooner rather than later. So with that, do we have any questions yet? Okay, I think maybe we'll start with that top one. Dr. Moore, can you provide a key advantage of your OTA versus a standard contracting route? Go ahead. Yeah?
So, the OTA, Jeff, let me explain the project that we had and put it into perspective. The project we had was entitled Development of an Alternative Large Animal Model for Organophosphorus Nerve Agent Efficacy Testing. So the Food and Drug Administration, as you know, you have to show a drug used in humans as both safe and efficacious for the indication that it's designed for. Doing safety studies in humans is not an issue as long as all the preclinical animal work was done. But utilizing nerve agents for efficacy testing of the drug, using those in humans is obviously not only unethical, it's unallowed. So the large animal model that's been used as the gold standard was the Indian origin rhesus monkey. That model is essentially not available anymore, and so we're at a roadblock in terms of being able to progress a medical countermeasure forward unless there's a new model. So that's that was the project that we had. I'm not sure how that work would have been put out on bid under a normal contracting process. For us, we responded to an RPP. We had 9 days to put in a white paper. The turnaround on that white paper was pretty quick. It was just several weeks. And then we were told that we were selected to put together a full proposal. So we only had about 3 weeks to put a full proposal together, and that included a cost proposal, which was essentially, in that when we experienced it, it was essentially a FAR-based. It had all the DCAA requirements, it had all the cost narratives, it had all the rationale and for salaries and so forth. So it was a fairly onerous process at that time. But we only had a couple of weeks to put that together. What happened then at that point, I don't know what happened. It sort of fell off the cliff, and it was almost 5 months before there was an award made. So when you want to put that in perspective to normal contracting at the earliest, it took more time from the release of the RPP to the award of the contract than it took for us to execute the project. There have been many changes since then. And so I'm willing to talk about that one if there's any questions on that. But I think the OTA process generally is small companies and large companies should be able to find it easier than waiting for an RFP to come out and putting in a full FAR-based contract.
Thanks, Dr. Moore. So since then, yeah, we definitely are trying to reduce the procurement administrative lead time. I have to meet with Dr. Roos and others on a weekly basis to explain what's taking so long. So we have definitely decreased the amount of time it takes to respond. But on the medical side, we still have some work to do, and that's part of my responsibility as well. On the CWMD side, some of the feedback I get is that we're going too quick. Especially when it comes to large companies that need to do teaming. So there's a balance there. We're trying to keep everybody happy, and sometimes we actually succeed. Next question, I think is a great question. So, and this, I can tell you, Mr. Bryce really doesn't like how much the some of the RPPs look like a FAR-based requirement. So too many OTA request for prototype proposals still look like FAR-based RFPs, and too many PMs still behave like they're under the FAR. What's being done to change that? So I can answer that, but at this point I'd like to toss that one to Ryan, though, from your perspective.
Thank you, Jeff.
Thanks, Jeff, and I understand exactly where that's coming from. From the program office, you're always thinking from the FAR-based RFP and going to this new process or newer type process where there's more flexibility in what you do with the OTA. It can be a little more challenging, especially having the pressure from perhaps the budget side and the contracting office or contracting within the internal office to want it to be a FAR-based or look more FAR-based. I think that a lot of it's going to come down to some more experience doing it. The OTA process, I'm not an expert on by any means from the contract standpoint, but it does allow that flexibility to put certain things in there. And I think that depending on the program office, they're going to want certain areas, at least for reporting, to be able to understand where you're going technically. I think, but the advantage of doing the OTA right now is really that you can talk with, we can go to industry early on, and after doing like the white papers, although there's a blackout period, you can't really talk to them afterwards, and going back and finding the details on that contract, you can actually work with industry to say, hey, this is what we want from a reporting standpoint, the budget, how does this line up with what you guys expect, and find really what could be new visits that everyone's sort of happy with. So said, I think that it's just going to take a little more experience with doing some OTAs, some program office, and really just up to the individuals to do that. Thank you, Jeff.
Thanks, Ryan. I'll say one of the biggest things that we've been able to do is train. So we've trained about 2,000 people, both in industry, academia, and in the government on how to use OTAs. That was just last year. And then again, we need to do a lot more training for people who have turned over, like agreements officer representatives. They have to be trained on how to not deal with wider workflow, what is advanced billing, all that kind of stuff. We are actually going to kick off a class this year. We're going to train government PMs on how to talk to industry. Some of them have been so divorced from actually engaging with industry under the FAR that they've forgotten. And at the same time with industry, some of our industry partners have forgotten how to talk to government. So we will be kicking that class off this fiscal year in 20, and I'll be teaching the government AORs myself. And if you want me to come to your company and teach your folks how to talk to us, I'll be happy to do so. I really like to get off the base. I'd like to come and visit you, see your capabilities, and get to know who's who. So, you know, feel free to ask. But I'd much rather do that than sit in my office and stare at the computer all day. There'll be more on that at the general membership meeting also in November, so we'll hit that topic again for sure. Okay, Dave and Dave, what is your approach to responding to OTAs? Are you pitching the ideas to the government first, then responding if and when they come out on the OTA? So let's start with Dave Hanson.
So far, no, we haven't been pitching any ideas to the government. I feel like the opportunities that come out amongst the different consortium sites, the opportunities are plentiful. We struggle sometimes to keep up with sifting through it and figuring out what we want to decide to pursue and what we don't want to pursue. So I don't know if there's anything that prevents us from bringing an idea to the government and then waiting for it to come out, but as it stands now, it's not been the model that we've gone with. When it comes to actually responding to it, again, we've got small staff program managers that will sit down and evaluate what it is. Being a small company, again, we've got a lot of capabilities so we can quickly adapt and meet a lot of these needs. And then again, we can reach out to the agreements officer. And Ryan just highlighted that open collaboration and communication you can have during that process is huge. So some of these requirements that come out. I saw the other question about something being similar to a FAR-based contract. I think some are on the opposite end too, where the requirements are pretty vague and need some clarification. So having that ability to go back and forth and truly clarify what the need is very pivotal. The overall process, I think, for the white paper is fairly straightforward. It's a 10-page limitation, which for us being a small company is a good thing. It allows you to be concise, say what you want to say, and then you can work in your detailed requirements into the statement of work that you have to provide as well. And again, can't say that enough, that collaboration and being able to nail that down and be on the same page with your requirements representing the government is crucial to success.
Dr. Moore.
Yeah, like Dave, we do not pitch any programs to the government. The way that we find out about the state of affairs is to understand the requirements, like for this afternoon when the program offices are going to pitch contract opportunities, we certainly make a note of that. The other thing that a small business like SciTech does is one, we don't have any intellectual property. We don't have any laboratories. We just have a lot of capabilities. And so we stay in contact with those companies that have technologies and laboratories to find where SciTech, a small business like ours, can play a role in a team. Teams are becoming more and more important in the OTA process, teaming up non-traditional and traditional contractors. So that's how we find out about it. We certainly don't go and pitch any particularly unique ideas directly to the customer.
Thank you. There was a perfect question here for Ryan, but it got sent to the bottom, so sorry. All right, so it looks like somebody is asking me, why does it take so darn long to award the final award? So that's a valid point. Problem is, we deal with reality. We had a couple of projects that you turned in your white papers and the evaluation team got deployed to a country overseas. And they were there for a few weeks before they even started the evaluation. Nothing we could do about it. They couldn't do the evaluation in country. Other times, there's one right now, there's one of the chairs of the evaluation board is out ill. There's been other ones where the chair went on maternity leave. So there's some reality that we have to deal with every day. In other cases, there are some project teams that struggle. Particularly, the evaluations haven't been that bad, so we engage with the evaluation teams. We help them through the process. If you know Phyllis Brown, she works in my office, and David Grieco, they are literally calling the project teams every day, if not sitting with them, to go through the process. So David will be going through the evaluation for that CK gas one that's out there now on the street at the end of the month, and he will be pushing that team. Where we really have a problem, though, is negotiating a statement of work. So we ask you to give us a draft statement of work. Sometimes they're awesome, especially if you've done it a couple of times, you see what we're looking for. But sometimes you may get part of your proposal and it's all marketing. So what happens is if you get selected for award, I personally download your statement of work and I will mark it up. And if it's all marketing, then it takes me and you way too long to get that stuff out of there because the statement of work is really what would be in your agreement. So if you could help us with that draft statement of work and just keep it as if it's a government document that would be used for your award, you save a lot of time. You'll save a week or two just right there. Then additionally, sometimes we haven't talked about intellectual property with you. So we ask you to make your intellectual property assertions in that statement of work. And then when we get to negotiating and finalizing it, then we find out that you want more intellectual property rights than we're willing to give you. And that negotiation goes back and forth, and sometimes that can take a long time. Other than that, this time of year is just bloody. So you are competing with about 100, maybe 150 other projects at Army Contracting Command in Jersey that are all going to award by the end of the fiscal year. So if you're in that queue and if your government team is really responsive, if you're really responsive and anticipate our requirements, respond as soon as you possibly can, that helps exponentially. Especially the academic institutions, they take forever. I call them up and I say, look, I need your pricing tomorrow, and I'm lucky if I get it 3 weeks later. Well, that's just unacceptable. So there's a lot of things. There's human factors, and there's just the fact is there's a lot of activity at Army Contracting Command in Jersey. But I can tell you in my shop, we have turned over. We have about 300% more staff than we had before. Some of them are in the audience, and we'll see our procurement administrative lead time go down. Tell your contracting people, they will hear from me if they get selected, and you'll be seeing us pushing both industry and government to get things done. If you want to talk about that afterwards, you're welcome to contact me, obviously. All right, this next question, let's look at this one. As a small business not having a prime experience, what should we do to ensure a good start upon award of the OTA? So I'm going to give this to Ryan, because from the government perspective, I know he can help you. Go ahead, Ryan.
Yeah, thank you, Jeff. Yeah, I'm glad you asked me to answer that. So I think that coming from the government side, let's just what's great is being able to work with industry, be collaborative early on. You know, as soon as we get through the whole OTA process, you know, what I want to be able to hear is someone call me up, someone being like, hey, what's the next thing to do to get started with this? Do a startup work meeting, things going on. And that's really just all about communication that we want to have between industry and what we have going on in terms of, you know, what are the next steps and how's this process going to go. Said we've worked with a lot of small businesses, and everyone has different experiences doing kind of stuff, doing the testing or evaluation, developing the technology for what we want to do. And it's a matter of just getting everyone in the same room, and the advantage really of OTA is from the start, really after, you know, we put out initial requirements, get proposals, do the detailed analysis, is that by then we've actually sat down and we've talked with whoever we're going to be working with several times to really hammer out and negotiate exactly what we want to do. So it's really everything leading up to that, leading up to the award and the start of that project that is going to help it get started, instead of merely a traditional FAR process where we're taking a requirement, throwing it over the fence, you know, and hoping that someone sifted it out and gave us exactly what we were looking for. So it's, you know, by that point, we said we're working with industry and we're ready to go when the contract is awarded.
Dr. Borden, Dave Hanson, you want to go ahead?
I'll say, again, the collaboration that Ryan said is key. I think another thing, and you touched on a little bit, Jeff, is just be concise, not only in the white paper, but in the statement of work. Be direct with requirements, get those ironed out with your agreements officer early on, and that'll help you hit the ground running right away. Getting a quick start a work meeting in place will also kind of enable you to just get that momentum and keep it going. A lot of these efforts are short term, could be 6 months, could be a year, and it's a lot to do. I'll say another piece for a new company that hasn't been prime before is listen to what the customer really is asking for. You don't always have to pitch what you already have or technology you already have, but make that so it's adaptable to what the customer actually needs.
Okay, thanks. Let's move on to this next one. I'll take this. Are there OTAs that handle research? So there's three types of authority. There's R&D, there's prototyping, and then there's follow-on production. And at Army Contracting Managers, they only have authority for follow-on production and prototyping. They do not have authority for research, R&D. But the Defense Innovative Unit, I believe, has the authority for R&D, but that's not consortium-based. And I know there are other ones throughout DOD. With Mike, do you have any consortium? You have any consortiums that are R&D-based? Okay, so Mike said that the National Shipbuilding Consortium does have the R&D authority. So that what I'll do is I'll take that for action, and I will put out a more comprehensive answer if there are other consortia-based R&D OTAs. And if you ask that question, feel free to get with me afterwards also, so I can put a name in the face. Okay. Let's take this next one. Can you identify two or three opportunities for improvement on the current OTA process? So I mentioned evaluations, which are on the government side, making sure your draft statement of work looks like a statement of work, not a marketing document on industry side. And then when you get to negotiating statement of work also, that is probably the biggest area for improvement, and that will be one of the things I'll be focusing on in FY20. Anyone want to take that?
Go ahead. Yeah, one suggestion I have, this is for the government side, is to make sure that the work you have smart buyers on your team, people that can understand the technology and can engage in a collaborative fashion with the performer. Because it's a trade-off between having control of the project, like on a contract, or working in a collaborative fashion with the OTA member. In the OTA process, that OTA member essentially, in negotiations, develops a statement of work, the cost, the timelines, and so forth. and the government has to be comfortable with giving up a little bit of that control. And to be able to do that properly is to have some people on your team that really understand the technology and can work collaboratively through the entire process. And so that's not only for the review of the white papers. It's great when you get a review on a white paper and they really get it. They understand what is needed and what you're offering. And then, but you need that all through the process, all the way through the final product. So there's maybe that's going on currently. I don't know, but I would make a suggestion that before they put out a requirement or an RPP, that the program office has the technical competency and the right people to mentor that program through the process.
Now that I'm thinking about that, probably a couple other things you'll see. So I was talking to the CBCAT team last week, and the first thing I said to them, let's do an industry day. So as industry partners, you get a vote in that. If you want us to do industry days, if you're looking for certain things from the government, let us know. We'll plan it accordingly so that it's worth your time. When I was in BD, the worst thing I could possibly do was spend a couple $1,000s to fly somewhere for an industry day that lasted 10 minutes. It just happened way too much. So especially for CBCAD and some of the other ones coming up, we will be soliciting your input on how best to conduct an industry day so we get the most benefit out of it. Okay, this next one I think is pretty interesting. If you only have the capability to rapidly build prototypes, is it advantageous to partner with a downstream manufacturer? I have a very strong opinion about that, but I would pitch that one to Dave Hanson.
I think there is potentially some advantage. We are in that unique seat to have kind of both abilities to do the rapid prototype and then to take it to manufacturing, but a lot of times that's not always really the end goal of what we're trying to do. A lot of times we're trying to just develop a technology and it may not fit into our really manufacturing production capabilities. So I would say it potentially could be advantageous. I think the challenge with that, again, is some of the downstream manufacturers could be larger businesses that we would need to partner with ahead of time, and given the short duration between solicitation and white paper submission, it's not a lot of time to get some of those agreements put into place. But I think overall the model is one that could definitely work and benefit both parties.
Just let me add, so the way that the follow-on production works is you have the authority to use it one time. And the members of the team that did the prototyping are the members of the team that will do the follow-on production. So if you're a small non-traditional defense contractor with maybe a patent or something you'd like to have developed into a prototype, I would highly suggest you team with someone who can handle the manufacturing and maybe even the logistics. So if you're a services contract that you can do logistics type products, that also to me is a place you should be teaming in the prototyping phase. You may not get any work in the prototyping phase, but you're on the team officially. And then when we go to follow-on production, then you would, by extension, you could flip who actually is the lead on that team, and then you would do the manufacturing, or maybe the logistics lead could be, you know, in the lead with the manufacturer and that original patent holder underneath. So that's something also, if you want to talk about that, I'd be happy to speak at length. Okay, I think someone's saying that we're giving you too much work to do these white papers. So I agree, I'll take this one. Consider how to minimize the burden on industry when submitting white papers and full proposals and still getting enough information to make a funding decision. My opinion is the medical consortium asked for too much. What they made Dr. Moore do a couple years ago to me was just ridiculous. I come from industry. I think 10 pages white paper and a draft statement of work is more than enough. If you need more pages, ask. If you want to have like a resumes or something in there, we can put those in an attachment. The bottom line is just ask it. If you don't ask, I can't help you. But the downside is that the statement of objectives might be 10 pages, and I'm asking you to respond in 10 pages. So yeah, it can be pretty tight. So the bottom line is communicate. In case you don't remember, all the way through the proposal phase, you can ask us questions. I want you to ask me questions. I don't want you to build risk mitigation into your price. Let's identify those risks and mitigate the risk at the proposal phase. Anybody else want to respond to that one? Yeah, Dr. Moore.
So if when an RPP comes out and you ask for some information in the white paper or the proposal, good companies are not going to bid on that unless they're all in. So they're going to go to a lot of trouble to provide information that, in fact, may or may not even be relevant to the award of that contract. Now, recently, they've gone to the enhanced white papers, and I think that's a real advantage. We didn't have that advantage in the early on when we did our project. We went through the white paper stage, the review, then you were invited to give a full proposal, then you had to write a whole other full proposal, and a very detailed, FAR-based, I might say, cost proposal. So now that you have the enhanced white papers, where you have you provide a more detailed technical approach to the requirement, and then you sort of give a draft statement of work and your milestones and so forth, and you submit that. And if you're fortunate enough to be selected, then you're asked to prepare a cost proposal. And there's a lot of effort to that cost proposal. As most contractors know, you want to get the number right. You want to be competitive. And so if you're not selected, you don't have to go through all of that. And so that's a real advantage to make that cut at that point. So I think that's a real improvement that's been made in the process of taking a little bit of the burden off the industry member.
Sir, go ahead.
I'd like to add to that also, coming from the government side, you know, having to write up the statement objectives, you know, one way to really look at that, you know, that's on the government is really not to address it like a FAR-based proposal. Don't put 100 specific requirements in there, or if it's in there, say, hey, these are objectives for this technology, but really emphasize what is at the core of what you're getting to, a better detector, a better protection, or certain capabilities is, you know, weight what you're looking at size, and then make sure that we get that across to industry, and hopefully some of that comes out too when we're talking with them before they submit their initial white paper for us. So I think that that's one way that we can help to minimize the burden so they don't have to look at a million different things or requirements right off the bat.
Dave?
I would add too, so specifically with the CWMD consortium, the templated format for the white paper, the enhanced white paper right now is pretty streamlined in my opinion. It has enough sections in there are adequate enough for you to convey what your technical approach is, what you want to deliver. Other consortiums are a little bit different, it's a little bit more challenging, but I would say overall the burden has changed over time and it's gotten a lot better.
Okay, thanks. Let's go on to this last question and then I'll just make some closing remarks. All right, so the panelists, have you experienced use with other consortium-based OTAs or just standalone OTAs, and what is the comparison? So let's start with Dave Hanson.
Yeah, like I said, we're a member of three right now. We have active contracts on two of them. And the process between the CEED, who's managed by CMG, and the CWMD, who's managed by ETI, while it's been similar, there's definitely been some more challenges on the CEED side of things. I think the overall process took a lot longer between submission and award. The way they had their white paper templated was very kind of prohibitive as to what you could put in. You had to really follow it to the letter of the law and the text. You couldn't change any section whatsoever there. I thought we had a little bit more flexibility with working with ATI in that process. On the invoicing side on both, I think similar ATI is a little bit quicker with paying invoices as opposed to CMG. I'm sorry if I'm throwing anyone on the bus right now, but that's just the reality that we've experienced over the past probably year and a half.
Thanks, Dr. Moore.
Yeah, as I mentioned earlier, we are a member of three OTAs, all of them managed by ATI. So the standardization in terms of how you operate, how you report to milestones, how you design statement of work and reporting requirements are all very, very similar. And so I'd like to end on a little bit of a positive note here for the OTAs and our experience for both the .C OTA and for the medical OTA. We've had nothing but good experiences in terms of collaboration and communication with the government. having government interactions with people that understand the technologies and the requirements. And also, and more importantly for a small business, being paid on time. So we've always, in all those interactions, we've always had a good good experience.
Thank you. So we've only got a couple more minutes. Ryan, how about you provide any final thoughts, and then I'll just close us out.
Yeah, thank you, Jeff. I guess some final thoughts in terms of any PMs or government folks who are looking at using one of the OTAs is really to start it off, start early, start putting things down the paper, trying to understand what your requirements are, understand the process, obviously, and where it lines up with funding. I know that we've been looking at, for FY20 projects, really that now is the time to figure out what those requirements are so we can move forward and hopefully award within the right time period in FY20. So start early and make sure we're talking with industry, talking with our partners to get projects going.
Thank you. Thank you all for your participation. Just some final thoughts. So I've made promises to General Burton and Dr. Cullen and many others that I will try to put out the forecast as soon as I make sure that the project was in scope for the CWMD or the medical. I post them right on the website. And if you're interested in a particular project, let me know and I'll put you in touch with the PM or the agreements officer representative and facilitate that communication. We do put out draft statements of objectives as soon as we possibly can. The problem is that the program is so efficient on the front end, there have been times when we released a SUM on Friday at 9 and then released the final RPP at 10. And I apologize, but that's just how efficient this is. And because we have so much going through the system, we do kind of push it on the government side as well. If you're not a member of the consortium and you're interested in one of these opportunities, you have to join sooner rather than later. Please don't wait for an opportunity to hit because there is a backlog at DLA, like I said, and you will not get in time. And then finally, please do check out the general membership meeting, the schedule for November 12th and 13th at the Marriott in Rockville, Maryland. It will be a joint event. The DHS CWMD office will be highlighted, but we'll also have CCDC, DITRA, and a whole lot of other government agencies there, and those program managers will be available to meet with you on a one-on-one basis. We'll have training, and it should be, I hope, one of the best events that you attend this entire year. So with that, I will close out and invite you, if you have any questions or comments about the OTAs, I'm the guy. I will answer the phone if you call me. Thank you very much.